Thank you. And thank you for inviting me, and thank you everyone for coming out. I'm going to read a few poems first from The Breakfast Machine. And the poems in this book are about kind of scary childhood things. And this is Magicians. They think the world is found in their pocket if they just pull out enough scarves. They think doves are for their sole amusement, that rabbits are content to live under their hat. They keep the halved bodies of all their mistakes in cellars with the blooded sequins and boas of their trade. They think they know what you're thinking, the card you hold close to your chest. Were you thinking Paul Daniels then? here's a doll. This is called The Doll's House. The trees that grow from the nursery walls do not rustle in the breeze of an open window. The jaws of the wardrobe do not snap shut when a crane fly bumbles into their waiting smile. But there is a shifting of furniture in the doll's house tonight, a slow dragging of objects across candlelit rooms. The kitchen windows steam up and the unmistakable smell of melting plastic drifts from the chimney. You will notice tomorrow your new doll is gone. You will find her blonde hair lines a mouse nest in spring. There you go. Another mousy poem. Okay, this is called The Tooth Mouse. Now, it's the equivalent to the tooth fairy. I think some cultures have a mouse. All of the teeth bought by the tooth mouse are piled up in an out-of-town warehouse. They are gnashing and grinding and want to return to the mouths of sleeping children. It is said they are whiter than bone, cleaner than meltwater, more innocent than the children themselves. But look at them here, all broken and angry, chewing at the cold metal door to get out. I'll read a couple more from this book. What shall I do? I heard a man talking on the radio a few years ago. He suffered from autophobia, which basically meant he was kind of scared of himself, of the kind of the blood and the heartbeat and all the kind of squishy things inside you that make you human. And this is kind of some of his coping mechanisms. So, bedtime story. The man trapped inside his body hears his heart pound like a hot little mouse on a wheel. Too many snakes squirm in the dark well of his belly. He feels his liver grow cell by cell. So he begins to live inside his head in the clean-cut world of numbers as drawn by a digital clock. At night, he sings facts to himself like lullabies and pushes at the heavy boat of his body into the empty and chemical dark. One more from this book. What shall it be? This is a bit strange. I won't say much about it. I think it's about my ex. You'll hear more about him a little bit later. Anyway, you asked what I was afraid of. I'm caught in a storm with the whole ocean of sky above me being whisked into a giant meringue. There is a card game just offset, and the 7 of 3 of hearts are whipped into the mixing. They bleed and leave a clot like a fertilized egg in the clouds, and I am watching this spectacle from the side of the road. From the far hills, an ant writ large brings its silhouette closer to reveal you as an unsaddled rider on its back. The sound of you reciting the first 20 elements of the periodic table over and over in the voice of a bull will be the last thing I hear as a card flips over, revealing itself to be Alexander the Great, no less. Don't ask about that one. Right, I'm going to be reading some poems now from Waiting for Bluebeard, which comes out next year. Now, it's kind of semi-autobiographical. It's kind of part real, part imagined. The first kind of two-thirds of the book are childhood poems. And and I'll start with this one. I was born in 1969, and my mother was waiting to watch men walk on the moon when she was massively pregnant with me. I think I was supposed to be born exactly that day, but I couldn't be bothered. I waited for a couple of weeks. This is moon landing. Somewhere beyond weather, men are reckoning the acreage of space and playing tricks on gravity. My pregnant mother watches with the millions in their front rooms as she waits, but I will not budge. Meanwhile, the men wrapped inside their skins trust their lives to science and whatever wonder brought them there. The suitcase has been packed for days. All the clothes are white or lemon. A man plays hopscotch on the moon. Now, in this part of the book, things talk. Okay, so the sea talks, and there's a cat, and it's what the something said, and this is what the dark said. The dark prefers to listen, has much buried away in its drawers and under its tongue. The rusted knife, the christening gown, the apple seeds sewn into its hem, a chronicle of undelivered letters. The dark likes not to get involved, holds stars and planets loosely in its arms as they dance. But when the dark clears its throat, dogs and wolves look down from the sky, and the four winds race from their caves. Yes, this is my, well, the family, I won't say my family, it's kind of based on my family, so this is the family at night. We were ragdolls after school and passed the long winter evenings like this. Father in his armchair with an unlit pipe. Mother in the kitchen pretending to eat. My sister and I with our small occupations. We saw little with our button eyes and spoke even less with our stitched up mouths. We played at playing till it was time for bed when Mother sewed our eyelids down so we could get a good night's rest. We always woke as our human selves to find the downstairs rooms had altered too. A chair unstuffed, a table's legs all wrong, and that one time, kittens gone from the basket, the mother's bone hollow meow. I must learn to meow that last meow. my grandmother features in this part, both of my grandmothers, but this is this particular one. Now, she used to live down the road from us, and she was ill for, she had cancer for about 2 years, and she would kind of ring us late at night when she was frightened. So, another 3 a.m. call. Every night, my grandmother rehearses her journey into the other world as her womenfolk stand by, rooted to this world by strong cups of tea. The air is electricity, and it's easy to imagine my grandmother's travels, how superfluous slippers might be. We dress her in her wedding gown, her auburn hair with violets. On the walk home, night fits around us like a freshly torn coat. What the stars said. Following a long afternoon of reflection, the stars no longer believed they were sheep waiting for a midnight field. They grew fearful of heights, inquired of the little girl as she prayed, "May we hide in your room?" So they flocked to her tiny house, heaved themselves under her bed, and began to burn holes in the rug. Some of these I don't really have introductions for. It's kind of like a loose narrative, I guess, especially the way I've put it together at the moment, actually. This is the inside out house. The house turned inside out, innards tumbled onto the grass, trees watching with the quick eyes of birds. One has laid eggs in the body of her parents' bed and is breaking them open with a pin-sharp beak. It eats the yolk, leaves the albumen to dribble down through the rusty springs. So, yeah, in the book, I think we watch my parents' marriage kind of fall apart. And yeah, this is a poem about my cousin Emma. She was about the same age as me, and she died when we were 22. Coming home. You disappeared slowly, hair first, the flesh from your bones. Then you were gone from Christmas like a bad taste magic trick. When you finally died, everything electrical in your room stopped working. The family tried to call you up on the Ouija board, but you must have been too far away. A year later, your mother heard you coming home late on a Friday night, brushing your teeth, taking your face off, everything. That's true. Not that the rest is lies, of course. Okay. This is a little prose poem. The story of fire. After fire had ripped through the trees and towns and left skeletons of houses and furniture, it turned its attentions on the graveyard. All my dead are there, neat in boxes, and fire skipped over their graves singing. When the song could not wake them, it pushed and shoved at the stones, but they would not budge. Once fire had squandered its strength on the stones, it shrank to the size of a single flame, which my mother blew out with a goodnight kiss. I'm going to read you some poems now from the second part of the book. So here, the girl that grows up in the first part of the book, she kind of there's a kind of a hinge poem. She's quite long, so I won't read it here. It kind of links. It's a kind of out of the frying pan into the fire type thing. And we all know that nothing happens, you know, good for a woman who'd end up living in Bluebeard's house, if the word living is the word. This woman is basically a story kind of about domestic abuse. And this woman disappears. But anyway, this is called Waiting for Bluebeard. The child in the garden wears a coat, collage from the skins of paper, sutured with the lengths of my hair. I am inside the house in a matching coat. There is no one to tell us not to, caught here as we were by the halloo of peacocks who turned tail the day we arrived. We are waiting for Bluebeard, and when he happens here in his grey silver car, he will unleash wolves like rain. So this is that. There's 9 or 10 poems that are threaded through this part of the book under the heading "The Disappearing," and this is the first of the disappearing. The tariff for crossing the threshold was a single layer of skin. She imagined a snake unzipping itself in one deft move. She imagined herself lithe inside the house, her new home. She didn't imagine the scarring nor the painstaking care required to leave the ghost of herself on the doorstep like a cold caller. So that was disappearing, and this is at the dress shop. There is a mention of Mybridge here. Mybridge was the photographer who kind of documented, well, he was the first person that started off the idea of the moving image. You might have seen the kind of images of horses. Have you seen that kind of thing of horses kind of moving? So kind of, yeah, anyway. But anyway, Mybridge makes a little appearance in here, and so does the zoetrope, which is the kind of twirly moving image thing. At the dress shop. At the dress shop, the assistants bustle as Bluebeard watches from an ornate chair. He has phoned ahead, and they come at her with his choices all prim on wire hangers. She parades for him, and so do all the other women in the mirrors. Everyone looks older than her. She imagines being animated by Mybridge, the drabbest dress painted onto her body. Bluebeard at the handle of the zoetrope, she spinning too fast for herself. So there's lots in here about kind of losing skins or chain or just kind of your outer layer. And this is, oh yes, this is dog, oh yes. Okay, dog. who, yeah, is Bluebeard's dog. She knew to grow him, so I'll start again. She grew to know him by his dog, gauged his humours by the slant of its ears, learnt when to keep low to the ground. Dog preceded her by 15 years. Every corner of the house, every midnight walk from the pub tattooed the map on his hide. Now, dog was half blind, his teeth and claws grown dull. She nursed him with milksop all his last week. When dog died, Bluebeard sobbed, held dog's fading warmth to him, murmured for hours into dog's empty ear. Later she found him outside, clay stuck to the soles of his boots, quarrying with pick and shovel, waist-deep in dog's grave. So this woman, through this part of the book, she's looking for a child, which is real or imagined or herself, and this is child. She must have been somewhere else when they cut her open, hauled the baby out and tried to zip her up like an empty bag. She must have been waiting for a bus or playing lawn tennis. She must have been Artagis, the mermaid goddess at the boating lake. That night, cries from her half-closed wound, and they watched her temperature soar, mapping it on a chart like the lunatic flight of a moth. She awoke as a rock in a fast-moving river. There was no child, no tiny warmth. There were voices and hands, all of them hollow. This is another of the disappearing poems. She stepped out of herself like a matryoshka, one full moon, looked along the row of herself at the hand-painted colours, checked each pair of eyes for what lived there. A scarf hung about each pelvic girdle to conceal the scar of each birth. Hearts were black hens held in each pair of arms, and cabbages grew from fallen seeds at their feet. When Earth spun away from the moon, she attempted to gather herself back in. And when she could not, she drowned the sun like a sack of kittens and threaded the rooster's song back into his throat. How are you doing out there? Are you all right? I'll read a couple more, I think I've got 4 minutes. I think this Bluebeard character is a little bit sad. I didn't want it all to be about Bluebeard being the bully. I mean, he's got his backstory as well. He also cries. So, Bluebeard at night. When she's gone to bed, Bluebeard sobs like a wolf from his leather armchair. Only the television responds, slips the leash of its power cable, dragging itself to its master's heel. She hears them leave the house like solemn drinking partners emptied into the night at closing time. Then she imagines the nocturnal insects entering the house by the grace of the left open door, and their frantic gathering round the hallway's false moon. So, yeah, there's lots of associations here between Bluebeard and the wolf. This is Bluebeard the chef. You coax the rabbit from its skin, cradle the bruised flesh ripped with shot. A deft incision, and soon the tiny heart is in your hand. Its stillness opens up a dark hole in the sky for you. You climb inside, and all the stars are dying eyes fixed into you like pins. So you slice each optic nerve and disappear. The knife completes your hand with such sweet eloquence. You part recall its amputation when you were wordless in your father's house. Okay, I'll leave you with an escape type poem, because she doesn't stay in Bluebeard's house forever. Thank you very much for listening. This is called Liminal. She has forgotten how to sleep, covets the house's slow breathing, its routine loosening of joints. Cats are singing in their extraordinary voices to the moon or whoever will listen. Angels are enzipping the sky, and she pictures herself black-feathered, hollow-boned. There is a fire on the other side of the city. There is a taxi waiting at the end of the drive. Thank you.